Hey there, I'm Lee Ullman here with some big news from the National Young Farmers Coalition. We're partnering with Heritage Radio Network on a special season of The Farm Report. It's all about what's happening with the Farm Bill and how it impacts farmers and eaters.
I am growing diversified vegetables on land that's been in our family for 150 years.
And so with the pandemic, gentrification, property values going up, we had to sell the land and we lost it.
Join us as we uncover the untold stories behind this massive piece of legislation that shapes how we grow our food, what we eat, and so much more.
The problems we have had, those are things that come from earlier Farm Bill and USDA policy, right? Like Earl Butts, get big or get out.
You know, it's my responsibility to know not only what I'm eating, but then like how that all came to be and realize like, wow, like this piece of legislation, all this money, like it's technically something that I support as a taxpayer.
While Congress debates the next Farm Bill, this is not just an invitation to listen. It's a call to action. Be part of the conversation. Subscribe to the Farm Report on Heritage Radio Network, wherever you listen to podcasts.
The following program has been brought to you by Cane Vineyard and Winery. Cane Vineyard and Winery supports Heritage Radio and the growing movement to change how Americans eat and how we think about our planet. For more information, visit www.cane5.com.
Hello, Mr. and Mrs. America, from border to border, coast to coast, and all the ships at sea. Streaming live from the County of Kings, Brooklyn, New York City, on the Heritage Radio Network. Are you ready for the fastest half hour on the internet today? It's the Mike and Judy Show, spanning the globe for high-minded hijinks and lowbrow kicks to bring you the best in sex, drugs, rock and roll, and nuclear fission. They're too bad for radio and too good-looking for television. And now, here they are, to pluck the low-hanging fruit of the literati. Your hosts, Mike Edison and Judy McGuire.
All right, we're back. And that was our announcer, Sal Paradise, hyping the low-hanging fruit of the literati, which we're going to get to today. We're going to be talking about the dark secrets of the noble and lonely art of ghostwriting. I'm Mike Edison, your daddy-o on the radio, here with the co-hostess with the mostest, the woman who is truly too hot for television, Judy McGuire.
Hello.
Hey, Judy, before we get started, I wanted to ask you, I was reading the paper today, I was reading about Anthony Weiner.
And his wiener.
And the Post is just, it's penis propaganda nonstop.
They are obsessed with his erection. Whether or not it is his erection, we don't know.
We can't say with certitude. Apparently, neither can he. But what I wanted to ask you is, have you ever sent a naked picture of yourself through email or a text or a sext?
I'm old school. I'm all about the Polaroids, and that was quite a while ago. Nobody needs to see my droopy boobs at this point in life. You know, once you hit 40, you should not be taking naked pictures.
I will confess, there is a naked photo of me somewhere passed out. It was taken when I was passed out on the floor of a hotel room in Tokyo, and it was I benefited, let's just say, from an oblique camera angle. So I'm not terribly embarrassed, but I don't understand how anybody in this day and age could put a picture of themselves naked on the internet, on their website, on their Twitter account, and not expect someone to see it, especially a guy who wants to run to be mayor of the smartest city in the world.
Well, did you see the Blake Lively nude pictures?
No, not yet.
If I looked like Blake Lively naked, I would be naked all of the time, and everyone in the world would have copies of those nude photos. I think if you're going to do it, you should just own it. Nobody who votes for Anthony Weiner is going to care that he sent a boner picture if he did. But sending it over Twitter, that's especially stupid.
Stupid! You know, these guys have got to learn that, you know, once the KY jelly is out of the tube, it's hard to get back in.
Yeah, it just doesn't go back.
And let the reaming begin. All right. Well, with that happy thought, let's get on to our guest today. We're going to be talking about ghostwriting, and whose ghosts are we busting today? Sarah Palin? Dick Cheney? Michael Jordan? Keith Richards? No.
Much better.
Much better. It's Snooki from the Jersey Shore. Wrestling superstar Ric Flair, not to mention Joan Rivers, Paul Simon, the New York Dolls, the Hardy Boys, and a very special guest coming up. What we're going to ask, is this just a dream gig or highfalutin literary prostitution? So let me introduce our guests. Val Frankel, our old friend, a best-selling novelist, award-winning journalist. She's written 24 books, including The Accidental Virgin and The Girlfriend Course, and contributed to dozens of publications, including The New York Times, Self, Allure, Glamour, Parenting, and Good Housekeeping. Her memoir, Thin is the New Happy, about overcoming bad body image after 30 years of dieting, was recently described as rueful, zestful, and surprisingly funny by the New York Times. And her new book, It's Hard Not to Hate You, will be out in the fall. But she's here today for her groundbreaking work with Snooki. She's the woman who put author and Snooki in the same sentence. They said it couldn't be done. And she has also worked with my favorite, my lifelong crush, Joan Rivers, on They Like Big Boobs, Woman's Guide to Beauty Through Plastic Surgery. Let's hear it for Val Frankel.
Woo! Yay, Val!
Yeah!
Also joining us is my old pal Keith Eliot Greenberg, a New York Times bestselling author and award-winning television producer. He's worked for 48 Hours, America's Most Wanted, the History Channel. He's done lots of true crime stuff. He's the author of over 30 nonfiction books, including December 8th, 1980, the day John Lennon died, and Love Hurts, the true story of a teen romance, a vicious plot, a family murdered. But he's here today, best known for his collaborations with Classy, Freddie Blassie, the Hollywood fashion plate, Nature Boy, Ric Flair, and our very special guest we're going to have a little later, superstar Billy Graham.
That's
Can you dig it? So how did you guys get into this ghostwriting business? You guys are career authors, you guys are fantastic writers, and here you are standing behind someone else.
Well, I mean, you know, you say, is this prostitution? What isn't prostitution? And, you know, some people need a voice, and sometimes they just need a person of our talents to help articulate that voice.
Yeah, I mean, and a lot of the people who use ghostwriters are obviously talented, intelligent people. Like Joan Rivers has written her own books before. She just doesn't have the time to do it anymore. And so she has to hire someone to help, and there's no shame in that, I think, from her perspective. And from my perspective, I got to hang out with Joan Rivers for six months.
So
that's
awesome.
Come on, that's awesome. She gave me tons of QVC jewelry and makeup. And
so what
she critiqued my outfits.
What does Joan look like up close?
I tell you, well, you know, no slam on Joan. The first time I saw her when I interviewed for the job, you know, and she walked into the room with this sort of sparkly caftan on that was unzipped in the back, like down to her granny panties. And before I even got a look at her face, which I was dying to see, she sort of came at me, you know, from the rear view backing up, like beep, 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 and said, "Can you zip me?" So, you know, before I even met her, I was zipping up her caftan.
Your hand was hovering near her butt.
That's right. I saw her, you know, 80-year-old pruny back. And then she turned around to face me, and I, you know, reared back in horror. And
was it indeed pruny, though?
Her, you know, it looked like old lady back.
Really? Yeah. She really 80, Joan?
She's 70-something, 75.
Wow. Because, you know, I'm thinking that maybe I could use, like, an internet sex tape of some sort to help publicize my next book. And I've been keeping her on the short list, but maybe it's time I moved on.
You'd get the mature audience.
There's a fetish for everything.
That's true.
What do you guys find about... Okay, Joan credited you, right?
She totally did. She was totally generous. There was never any question that she... It was a book about plastic surgery, a nonfiction guide to, you know, what we called her favorite hobby. And, you know, obviously she's not going to do that reporting.
No,
you know, and interview
not.
10 plastic surgeons and... You know, do the internet research and look at the videos of what actually happens when she's when she's out cold. So she wasn't going to say, "Oh yeah, I spent a year reporting plastic surgery." So she gave me credit as a reporter.
What about you know the Snooki book? You weren't credited, but it wasn't a big secret either.
Well, I thought if anybody was going to blow the lid off celebrity novel ghostwriting, it would be Snooki. Because honestly, who on earth would believe that she could sit in front of a computer for more than 3 minutes? I mean, there was a great scene in Jersey Shore season 2 or 3 where she actually did sit in front of a computer to type a note. And she misspelled like every word. She didn't know how to type.
She's only read apparently right. 2 books, if that's even true.
Exactly.
Which is including nothing. Her own, I hope.
Sarah Palin has written many more books than she's ever going to read in this lifetime.
Right. Yeah. And her ghostwriter is well known too.
Right. What's her name?
Lynn Spear, I think, or Lynn Shear.
And she was and she had worked on like Christian books and these sort of like hardcore right wing.
Right.
Sort of.
She
books
has an, her niche.
Yes, her niche. And Keith, how did you get into writing for wrestlers, another race not known for their literary prowess?
Well, that's not exactly true, because if you listen to old-time wrestling promos, a lot of the wrestlers were rather articulate, and superstar Billy Graham, who'll be here in a moment, was one of the most articulate of all. I think he said something, he said, "I feel good and I look even better." And he said there was something else, and he said like a cashmere sweater. So he could really turn a phrase.
How much time did you spend with him?
Well, superstar Billy Graham, I was fortunate enough to spend months with. And that was a guy I really looked up to. He was a great promo man, and he was the prototype for both Hulk Hogan and Jesse the Body Ventura, the bleach blonde, bronzed Adonis. And you know, he could really, he had been in the ministry when he was much younger, so he really had a way with words. And so we would watch old wrestling tapes, and he would tell me what he was thinking during those periods. But we would also watch movies together, and we would eat Mexican food together, and we had a pretty good time.
Val, how much time did you spend with the Snookster?
I've never met Snooki.
Were you invited to the book party?
Neither is she.
She didn't have a book party. I had these fantasies of showing up at the book party, like, dressed totally in black, or, like, with a burqa on, or...
Well, I just want to, you know, I have read some of the Snooki book, and it's wonderful. It's fine. You know, I took objection. I know we both did do a story in the New York Times. Was it this weekend, last week, with some smarty pants, you know, Jewish literary agent.
Ira Silverberg. Right?
Ira Silverberg. Fuck him, all right? Ira Silverberg, are you listening? Fuck you, okay?
On the radio. Let's minimize the F-bomb thing.
Ira Silverberg, fuck you, okay? What he says is... he wants to know, the question is, this is a quote, I think for many of us, is it simply commerce and we should laugh it off, or does it take a slot away from a legitimate writer? And to this...
What's a legitimate writer?
First of all...
And now we're going to talk about the New York Nazi Times. I mean, you know, since... say, the last great thing they did, or the last momentous thing they did, was apologize for Stalin.
What is a legitimate writer? First of all, the person who wrote Snooki's book is a best-selling author, a legitimate journalist for many years, with 30 books under her belt. Okay, so not even talk about what's legitimate or not. I am offended at this concept, too. Does it take a slot away from this legitimate writer, as if there were a finite number of slots in the publishing business?
Well, there is a finite number of dollars, but the point is that a book like the Snooki book, called A Sure Thing, New York Times bestseller, made a fuckload of money. Sorry,
for
Judy,
publishing.
And it, you know, for that imprint at Random House, and no, that was Simon & Schuster, sorry.
Oops. What was that?
You know, and that enables that publisher to buy a small, sleepy first novel by a literary novelist.
And keeps editors in their paychecks.
Yeah.
I think that's great. You know, I don't feel in any way when Snooki's book comes out, or Nicole Richie's book comes out, that it's knocking Judy or I off the bookshelves.
Right.
In no possible way. So who's reading Snooki's book? Who do we...
Well, I know from the book readings that, or from her many signings
the
that she did.
The book readings?
She did not actually do any readings. I thought it would be awesome if she did the...
You're fantasizing
book.
Now. Right, I know. You're living
signings,
your gimmick.
You know, they were kids like, you know, my daughter, like these teenage girls who think Jersey Shore is hilarious, who think Snooki is, you know, charmingly daffy. And they bought the book because they wanted to, you know, read a novel that would be like that.
I think it's fair enough. I have no problem with a Snooki novel. Well, ghostwritten. It's just a brand extension.
Well, it wasn't a novel. It was a novel.
Oh,
it was a novel.
Well, that's, you know, this is where you guys are in different kind of rackets. I mean, you do memoirs specifically, you know, autobiographies. And to ghostwrite a novel is a whole different beast.
Right. Well, the Joan book was, that was like a reported book. It wasn't a memoir. But I am doing a memoir now for a celebrity. It's like service and memoir. But yeah, I mean, I'm trying to cover every single base. I'm trying to keep my kids, you know,
because you
in
are
Urban Outfitters.
You are a legitimate writer,
right?
That's right. People don't understand what working writers really do. I mean, it's nice to go out and write the great American novel and be able to have the time, the resources to sit at your desk 10 hours a day. Mm-hmm. But the truth is, we write all sorts of things. I've written all sorts of press releases, and this is another type of ghostwriting too. I write for, you know, rock and roll bands all the time, and I'm always creating quotes. I mean, some of these guys I talk to, now, and this is true, and here I'm gonna out my friend David Johansson a little bit of the New York Dolls, for whom I just worked. But I talk to him and I ask him about the new record. He goes, yeah, well, we had to make it, you know, it was kind of a rush, but somebody said we had to make it so we can stay on the road. And I'm like, ack, you know, thank God I'm not a journalist. You know, I work for you. It's okay. We'll fix it, you know, in the edit. But you can't say that to a journalist. That's terrible. So I go home and I ghostwrite for David Johansson. which actually brings up a question of authenticity. Talking about who's writing these books, I was making the joke before, Viz the New York Dolls. My friend Dave Thompson wrote a book called I Hate New Music, The Classic Rock Manifesto. He mentions that David Johansen was once in a band with Cyril Sylvain and three other guys, and it was called the David Johansen Band, and no one gave a shit. And then 20 years later, David Johansen was in a band with Cyril Sylvain and three other guys, and it was called the New York Dolls, and everybody got excited. So it really begs, you know, who cares? And what really does authenticity mean?
Okay, what does authenticity mean? Authenticity is in a person's mind. It's like their relationship with a higher power. It's how you interpret it.
Well, I guess I would say authenticity and integrity go together. Mm-hmm. And for the ghostwriter, you know, I feel like it's an authentic writing experience if I feel like my integrity hasn't been compromised. And doing a novel for Snooki, I feel like it was so above board that she didn't write it that at no point did I feel like I was, you know, selling out.
Yeah,
or,
you weren't tricking or, anyone.
No. Yeah, I mean, and she didn't either. She mentioned my name in every interview she did. She gave me credit on the acknowledgments page. I mean, she basically said, you know, I named the characters and had two plot points. But
so Snooki's a mensch.
She's totally a mensch.
Well, right on.
I mean, and she talk about authentic emotion. Here's this girl who does not lie at any point in her existence.
No, she's not capable. She's not capable
she,
of guile.
Exactly. She just can't be. She is
She's like a kitten.
Well, as opposed to professional wrestling, which is a business based on lies.
It's a business based on lies, but the irony there, of course, is that what they experience is real. They're in pain every night. Their families break up. And they live for this ideal. And, you know, superstar Billy Graham will be here in a minute or so, and he'll be able to elaborate on that even more. But I feel that, you're talking about authenticity, that was something I wanted to convey in all of my wrestling books, that this isn't a cartoon show for these guys. This is the real thing. And it has real, long-lasting impacts on them.
That's right. Wrestling hurts. All right, tell you what, we're going to take a quick break. I got a special song I want to play, Johnny Cash's Ode to Ghost Writers. And also want to plug our friends at bakeanddestroy.net who are holding Sugar Slam 2011. It is a wrestling-based bake-off. So please visit them at bakeanddestroy.net. We've got some killer cupcakes and some pile-driving pastries.
He rested as he went along his way. When all at once a mighty herd of red-eyed cows he saw plowing through the ragged skies and up a cloudy draw. Their brands were still on fire and their hooves were made of steel. Their horns were black and shiny and their hot breath he could feel. A bolt of fear went through him as they thundered through the sky. For he saw the riders coming hard, and he heard their mournful cry. Yippee-yi-oh!
All right, here we are back on the Mike and Judy Show on the Heritage Radio Network, being broadcast live from Roberta's Pizzeria in Bushwick. Wow, that's scary. But I have a feeling...
Is that a ghost?
I have a feeling it may be the greatest champion in WWF history. The woman's bet and the man's regret. The man with the power too sweet to be sour. What you see is what you get, and what you don't see is better yet. Are you there, Superstar?
I'm here.
All right, Superstar Billy Graham.
Hello. All right. Yay.
All right. And Billy, the reason we have you here today is we're talking about the art of ghostwriting or co-authoring. And I'd say my experience co-authoring your book probably was my most fulfilling professional endeavor ever. Billy, are you there?
Yeah.
Are you in church?
I think
Billy, can we hear you? Hello?
Yeah, hello.
Okay. All right.
Out Sunday. Superstar could
No, he is in church. He's definitely in church. He may have stepped outside, and that may be the chorus we hear. As I mentioned to you, he was in the ministry as a younger man. All right. Can you hear us now?
Yeah, very, very good. I can hear you very good.
Okay. And as I said before, the topic here is ghostwriting, and I feel that co-authoring your book was probably my most fulfilling professional experience.
Oh, that's quite a compliment to me, then. My gosh. Considering the caliber of writing that you have done, do, and will continue to do, is an extreme compliment to someone talking about a grant.
You and Keith spent quite a lot of time together writing this book, and you feel that it sounds like you. It's your voice. It's your book.
Oh yes. Oh, he captured me coming out here to Phoenix and going to the gyms I trained at and being in person and looking at photographs, wrestling magazines, and of course his in-depth knowledge of the business to begin with. There was nothing he did not know, does not know about professional wrestling, so it made it such an easy thing to do. It was a great pleasure. It was like so simple. It wasn't a drudgery thing at all. It was so easy. It was fun. It was exciting. It was like everything flowed. We everything just flowed from the man, and he captured. There's no question about it. He filled in all the gaps perfectly, absolutely perfectly.
Great. And you know, one of the memories I have is I remember you and I were eating Mexican food one day, and there was a very attractive waitress serving us, and we began chatting with her, and you said, "Well, you know, I'm the former WWF champion, and this here's my co-author." And she looked at us like we had just escaped from the mental hospital. Like, these two guys are throwing a line like that on us.
Yeah, she couldn't quite understand what we were talking about. But the Mexican food was good. It was good, authentic Mexican food.
That it was. Oh, we've been using the word authentic. And that's something, Mike, you should ask him
well,
about.
Well, that's the question. When you're writing a book about wrestling, where do you break kayfabe? Where do you know to draw the line, to pull the curtain up or to leave the sheet lying over the bodies where they lay?
In my case, you pull the sheets back and reveal the dead body. You don't hide anything, not in this day and age. I suppose some wrestlers would, but in my case, no. And especially with a skilled writer of Keith Greenberg's caliber, it would be foolish to try to save any... anything that should be written, it just doesn't make sense in this day and age of the way our culture is. Even though the book was written, I don't know, going on 5 years ago, maybe, I don't know for sure. But still, no, not with my nature of. I knew I was in the entertainment business. Period. And I was there to entertain the folks and then sort of translate that into a book with a writer of Keith Greenberg's skill, caliber, and
thanks for putting me over.
Is what was very important in this case.
Well, that's a professional. He knows how to sell, right?
That's right.
Well, Keith, why don't you talk about how this is, working with Superstar is different from working with some of your other subjects. Ric Flair, whose book became New York Times bestseller.
That's true, yes. I think there was, from the outset, an implicit trust there. Billy knew that I was advocating for him. I think in Ric Flair's case, although I'm proud of that book and very proud to have worked with him, he didn't know me as well. I wasn't a reward to him, like, hey, you get to work with Keith Eliot Greenberg. I was kind of put on him. The publisher said, this is who you have to work with. And he was like, who the hell's this guy? Superstar Billy Graham called me up and requested that I be his co-author. So from the outset, we were a team.
I think that's great. And here's superstar Billy Graham, a guy known for his outsized ego, who you're telling me basically is a pussycat and sounds completely without an outsized ego when it comes down to doing the job.
Well, he wanted to make his points, and he had a voice that he needed to convey to the public, but he put that trust in me, and I'm grateful for it.
Right on. So, superstar.
I think that Ric Flair also, a problem with Rick, who I love dearly, I think he also had still had some sort of problem of protecting the business at that point. Mm-hmm. I think there was some sort of subconscious mindset of him protecting. I thought there was nothing to protect. There was nothing sacred. There is nothing sacred, holy, or anything about pro wrestling. It's pure entertainment. And so maybe in Rick's case, he felt he had to shelter maybe something, I don't know, but I just felt such freedom because with Keith, of course, because his knowledge of the business is what really, really, and his enthusiasm, I think, also was revealed because of my acceptability of Keith knowing the business and me. To reveal the business as it is, entertainment.
Well, I think we're at a point now, aside from wrestling as well, with other forms of entertainment, with the celebrity memoir in general, I think we're a little bit more free to tell all than we used to be. You think, Val?
Oh, yeah, mm-hmm. Definitely. People are, with the internet and nude pictures and, everybody has their own reality show, there are no secrets anymore, and yes.
So there were no wrestling scandals or personal.
Oh, there's plenty of scandals.
That you didn't. Was there anything that the Reverend was reluctant to share?
Not the Reverend. The Reverend. He took his name from the Reverend, but his name's Superstar. You know what? I don't know if there was anything that you weren't willing to share. I think you pretty much came clean about everything.
Oh yes, certainly, of course, from the abuse of steroids to prescription drugs to everything, to blading, to everything that that Vince McMahon would allow. Now, we laid it all out there, but Vince, I don't know, Keith would know better than me what Vince would pull at that time frame and not really allow us to get into.
Right, because it was an imprint of WWE.
Right.
But I wasn't restricted about anything that I said.
Right, but this also brings up you did the Iron Sheik's book, which has never seen the light of day.
That's true. I did the Iron Sheik's book also for a WWE imprint of Simon & Schuster, and by then the company had taken a PG-13 turn. And as a result of that, the book was never published. And as if you listen to the Howard Stern show, you can imagine why.
Now, he's been very open about smoking crack and all the hookers and whatnot.
You should not hookers, but smoking crack, yes.
You should self-publish. Do an ebook.
I'm not going to do that.
Who needs a publisher anymore, right? I do. All right, I'll tell you what, we're getting to the end of our 30 minutes, but why don't you guys stick around, okay? Let's talk more about ghostwriting. I want to hear it once again for superstar Billy Graham,
yay!
The greatest champion in the history of the World Wrestling Federation. Truly, there would be no chumps like Hogan without him. You're the best, superstar. Thanks for being on. And let's wrap it up for now, but let's come back for part 2 of ghostwriting. We're going to talk more about Snooki, more about Joan Rivers, and Judy's going to tell us about working with the Hardy Boys. So, for Judy McGuire, Keith Elliott Greenberg, and Val Frankel, I'm Mike Edison. But come back next week for part 2 of our story about ghostwriters. This is the Mike and Judy Show.
Thanks for listening to this program on the Heritage Radio Network. You can find all of our archived programs on heritageradionetwork.com, as well as a schedule of upcoming live shows. You can also podcast all of our programs on iTunes by searching Heritage Radio Network in the iTunes Store. You can find us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter for up-to-date news and information. Thanks for listening.
This is Behind the Scenes Food News with Katie Kiefer. All of the trade papers are just buzzing with the information that Mark Zuckerberg, the founder of Facebook, has decided that he is only going to eat food that he himself has killed, as in proteins. So thus far, he's killed a goat, a pig, a chicken, and some fish. But he's going to start hunting, he says, so that he can, you know, basically be more mindful of what he is putting in his mouth and into his body. And to quote a CNN Money article, he says, "This year, my personal challenge is around being thankful for the food I have to eat. I think many people forget that a living being has to die for you to eat meat. So my goal revolves around not letting myself forget that and being thankful for what I have. This year, I've basically become a vegetarian since the only meat I'm going to eat is from animals I've killed myself. And thus far, this has been a good experience. I'm eating a lot healthier foods, and I've learned a lot more about sustainable farming and the raising of animals." This has been Behind the Scenes Food News with Katie Kiefer.
Did you know we have a beer show? Check out a small clip from Beer Sessions Radio.
All right, welcome back to Beer Sessions Radio on Heritage Radio Network. I'm Jimmy Carboni from Jimmy's Number 43, and I'm here with Ray Dieter from the DBA Boys.
Hey, Jim.
Ray, this is a fun show. We're drinking Belgian beer. We're drinking Ichtigum, hanging out with the guys from 124 Rabbit Club. We got Don and Wendy from Van Berg and the Wolf. Well, let's go back a little bit to kind of build your pedigree. So the two of your top brands that we love and that you have now, Scaldis and Saison DuPont.
Yeah, exactly.
Tell us how you met those guys, how you started working with them.
Well, Saison DuPont was really... that was.
If you want to hear more, head over to heritageradionetwork.com where new episodes of Beer Sessions are posted every week in our archive. And don't forget to subscribe to the podcast in iTunes.